mediocrity. You know, mediocre is average, it's uninspired, it's clearly unremarkable, it's listless, it has no passion. It's kind of like kissing your cousin. It's like going to the big dance and slow dancing with your brother and your sister. It's like working really hard for a season and getting a participation certificate. Mediocrity is that kind of life. But greatness, greatness is 180 degrees different. Man, it's about excellence and diligence and passion and pouring it all out. It's like saying, I do to the love of your life and celebrating the rest of your life every year on your anniversary. It's like starting pursuing a college degree and finishing because you know God has wired you in such a way with excellence to pour the rest of your life. It's like to defending a country's ideals and giving your life away on a boat, a plane, on the ground, in a foxhole. It's excellence. It's getting up every day and teaching students and believing in them and leading them to believe more in themselves. Mediocrity or greatness? They're 180 degrees apart. Could it be that these trajectories determine the destination of your life? And so let me ask you today, did God create you for mediocrity? Or did the God of eternity, the God who created everything, create your life for greatness? I believe He did. And I want to challenge you today to not live another day's breath walking down this road. I want to challenge you and invite you to walk down this road. Hey, welcome to Wellspring Church. We have had an incredible weekend. We exist to connect people to Christ, to help them know Him. He's the wellspring of life. We want you to walk with Him for a lifetime and beyond. We believe that all of us need to be taking spiritual steps day by day by day. We want to help you take spiritual steps today and for a lifetime. And so welcome today. Look around at all these blue teal shirts. Man, Denial has been incredible, hasn't it, students? All right, let's give it up one more time. I hear it's all about the drivers. I heard the drivers is what made it. Woo! Let's hear the drivers, all right. Oh, man, we got a bunch of guys who literally thought the whole weekend was up to them. Man, they nearly ran over about six of our kids out in the parking lot yesterday. They raised nearly 3,000 cans of non-perishable things. They're going to go and feed homeless people. They got tons of bags of diapers. They're going to go to one of our crisis breakers. It's incredible. And parents, yeah, we need to applaud that, yes. And parents, I know that you would want to thank all those who are involved. And in fact, we're taking up a collection. I'm going to pay that they do it again next week and take all my kids one more time. Woo! And all the parents have actually, yeah. Absolutely. 48 hours all by ourselves. Ooh, that's feeling pretty good. Feeling loose. All right. Call to greatness. Our students have been challenged over the past 48 hours to live a life of greatness. Now, don't miss this. It's not greatness according to what the world says. It's a counter-cultural greatness according to what Jesus Christ says. Greatness is a journey of faith. It requires leaning into His presence. It requires giving our lives amidst the fears, the frailties, the failures of humanity. And we all have them. We're all broken. Nobody lives a perfect life. The kingdom of greatness is about serving. It's not self-seeking. It's about sacrifice. It's not a pursuit of pleasure. It's about putting others first and loving the least and the lost. It's about making disciples of Jesus. The focus is always toward Him and modeling what greatness looks like to this world. Jesus described greatness as this: love God with all that you are, with all your breath, with all your passion, and turn to love others and do the same. That's what greatness is. He said, man, you want to please God? You want to enter the kingdom of heaven? That's it. When I give you breath, do that. And he said constantly, take up your cross, follow me. Do these simple things. It requires some discipline in your life. And most of all, he said, you got to let me into your life. You got to let me lead. You got to get first things first. Don't miss that. You can't live a life of greatness on your own. I've got to be the center, the source, the savior. The very trajectory of your life. Now I want to share a true story. It's found in history. It's recorded in scripture about a man who did just that. He let God lead his life. He put first things first, and he lived an amazing life of greatness. Today, all of us who desire to live by faith and who stand today praising God until he takes us, we're standing on his shoulders and many other people of faith. His name is Caleb. His name is Caleb, son of Jephunneh, the Kenizzite. I want you to listen carefully as I summarize his story and the platform from where greatness started. Students, I don't want you to miss this, because this message is for you. And I do believe he's going to speak to all of us today. Those of us that are older than 21. But I would tell you this. If you can capture what happened in Caleb's life and carry it the rest of your life, you're going to live a life of greatness. And so I want you to listen to who Caleb was. When the nation of Israel, somewhere between a couple hundred thousand to 2 million people, scholars aren't exactly sure how many people were in bondage in Egypt. And God called them out. He caused the plagues to come upon Egypt and he released them. Pharaoh's heart was hard and he said, man, please take these people. And the Exodus began. It's all recorded in scripture. And these masses of people began to walk and they ultimately get to the Red Sea and God parts it and they walk. And as they're moving forward, they get close to the Jordan River and they're about to cross over. They're about to cross over to the land God had promised them. They're about to cross over to the land God had already spoken to the prophets of old, and he'd already told Moses, and he'd already told the people, we're going to leave bondage and go to some place that's unbelievable. And here's what happened. They walked into this land, and Moses said, let's send in some spies. Let's go into this land, because we've heard this land is pretty amazing, but we've also heard there's some potential difficulty in this land. And so he picked somebody from every single family, every single tribe, there were 12 of them, and he says, I want you to go into the land. As they walked into the land, here's what they found. They used a term saying the land was flowing with milk and honey. Man, the finest of the finest, the best and biggest grapes, the best and biggest olives, the best and biggest trees, the best and biggest cattle and oxen and sheep, and they went to the water, and it was pure, and it was amazing. It was almost undescribable. It was the promised land. And so they asked the people, tell us what you saw. And these 12 tribes stood up and publicly they began to give testimony about what they'd seen. Publicly they declared how amazing it was. Now, if you've been in slavery all your life, you were born into slavery. By the time you were 8 or 9 as a boy, you were already working for Pharaoh to build all the stuff. As a woman, you were working just to cook and clean every day to feed your brothers or your dads who were working as slaves. They worked 7 days a week for 400 years. They never had a day off, ever. And you hear a report, you won't believe what this land has. You can imagine your heart's going, let's get there. Oh my gosh. This is amazing. And while they're standing there hearing this and their heart's about to leap out of their chest, no sooner did the spies declare all this publicly than one of them said, but we can't go. And another one says, it's impossible. And another one says, it's impossible because there's giants. And another one says, no, no, the giants use, but there's all sorts of stuff that we're scared of, the unknown. It's bigger and better than anything we've ever imagined. In fact, let's get another leader. Let's go back to Egypt. Let's go back to bondage. Enter Caleb. Caleb stands up. We must do it. This is God's land. He promised. We gotta go. And the people started talking. In fact, the Bible says they talked all night. Now listen up. This is what they started doing. Well, there's 10 of them saying it's impossible. Only 2 of them said it's possible. I don't think it's possible either. And the Bible said they started complaining, grinding, griping, whining, all sorts of other things. You know what? Misery loves company. It is easier to complain. It's easier to be mediocre and simply look at all the negative things around. It's called scarcity thinking. Instead of living by faith with excellence toward the abundance of God. And the final words after the night And Moses called the people together. They stood up and said, "We can't go. It's impossible, and we won't go." And in front of these naysayers, potentially 2 million of them, two men did something. Two men. They immediately stood up and they ripped their clothes apart. Oh, they weren't about to streak, although the Bible is full of a couple of streakers. If you want to go home and look for something fun, look for that today. You can Google it and find out the stories. It was an expression of emotion. It's so much passion that they believed in. They said, "We won't put up with this." And they ripped their clothes. And then they spoke up. And Numbers 14 records it this way. Some of you are taking notes. I'm going to help you fill in the blanks. If you want to turn to Numbers 14, we're going to end up in Joshua 14. We say it all the time at Wellspring. We want to get in the Word of God. We want the Word of God to get into us. Listen to Numbers 14, verse 6. Joshua, son of Nun, Caleb, son of Jephunneh, said to the entire Israel assembly, "The land we passed through and explored is exceedingly good." They're recounting everything the other 10 had already said. "If the Lord is pleased with us," listen to that. "If the Lord is pleased with us, He will lead us into that land. A land flowing milk and honey. He'll give it to us. Only do not rebel against the Lord. Do not be afraid of the people of the land, because we will devour them. Their protection is gone. The Lord is with us. Do not be afraid of them." Well, because of their unbelief, history reports this. Because of their mediocrity, God speaks to Moses and says, "The entire generation of people who would not believe me, who would not walk toward greatness, they're going to die in the desert. For 40 years, they're going to wander around." And all the current generation, all, somewhere between 200,000 to 2 million people died. Yet two families and the descendants of those who had been unbelieving got to walk into the promised land. Joshua and Caleb. Why did they get to go? Because they lived up to the call of greatness. They lived up to it. And here's some characteristics if you're going to live up to your call of greatness as well. Greatness requires disregarding the crowd. Disregarding the crowd. Disbelief can be contagious. It's infectious. Sometimes it's deadly. You've got to learn to disregard the popular opinion polls. You've got to learn to live according to the voice of the Heavenly Father. I pray over my children all the time. God, help them to hear God's voice more than the voice and the cacophony of sounds that are happening in their culture and among their peers. Help them to hear God's voice most of all. Here's a fact of life, young people. People who lack faith, people who don't have courage, people who lack confidence, they don't want to live a life of greatness. You know what they want to do? They're going to try to pull you down. They want to pull you down. They would rather do that than allow you to live a life of greatness. Because if your life is elevated, it makes them feel worse. Don't let them pull you down. Your parents are in the back saying, "Yep, been there, done that." Humanity is the same all throughout time. People who choose to say, "I'm going to walk by faith. I'm going to live according to the call that God has on my life." The crowd is going to try to hold you back. Turn a deaf ear to doubters. I love what Max Lucado says. People have a right to say what they want, but you have a right not to listen to them. So don't. Now listen carefully. Those in the desert will understand this. But as a person of faith, don't be a cactus either. Don't get prickly. Don't get all hard on the outside. Learn with grace and truth and love how to engage in relationships. Pour deeply into your friendships. Learn what you believe and then have genuine answers to questions that are transparent and real. Be loyal and trustworthy with transparent moments when people are honest and they open up and they bear their burdens. Be loyal, discreet, learn how to handle those. Love unconditionally always. That's what Jesus did. And learn to give your life away unselfishly. Don't be a cactus. But don't be a people pleaser either. Because if you try to be a people pleaser, you'll please no one at all. So you got to walk a fine line and your call to greatness. Not only does it require not paying attention to the crowd, it requires filling your heart with faith. Filling your heart with faith. It looked at life differently. Later in this passage in Numbers, God is speaking. Moses is called to record it by God's Spirit. Here's what he said. Not one of those who saw my glory, this is God's words, and the sign that I performed in Egypt, in the wilderness, but who disobeyed me, and they tested me 10 times, talking about the plagues. Not one of them will ever see the land I promised on oath to their ancestors. He'd been telling them this for years. No one has treated me with contempt, will ever see it. But because my servant Caleb has a different spirit, it's something different going on inside of him. It's something different happening within his heart and his mind. Because my servant Caleb has a different spirit, follows me wholeheartedly, I will bring him into the land and that he went to, and his descendants will inherit it. Okay, listen carefully. It takes faith to speak up contrary to public opinion. It takes faith to get out of bed some days. It takes faith to climb a mountain. It takes faith to attempt to do great things for God. You must feed your heart with faith. Because whatever you feed grows. I said that last week. Faith is not natural. Faith is not natural. You know what's natural? Doubt, fear, complaining, complacency, pity, all that's natural. Humanity would rather try to live on our own experience. Well, it happened this way in the past, or it happened with me in this way, and so I'm going to live based on my own experience. I'm going to trust myself. That leads to our attempt to control, our attempt to try to manipulate people and circumstances. That's not faith. That's natural. That's human. But faith is about trust, and we have to feed that. We have to feed trust in who God is. Anytime we try to feed doubt, fear, complaining, manipulating, control, it's going to lead to defeat and depression. It's going to lead to defeat and depression. It masks mediocrity and a trajectory of life. You know what we try to do? We try to solve and ease the pain. So let's be real. We try to solve and ease the pain by popularity, drugs, sex, alcohol, maybe success, busy lives, more money. That's how we try to mask it. Because we're leading down this road of mediocrity. And it's not fulfilling. Because that's not what God created us for. And yet we fall into the human natural tendencies day by day by day. And yet greatness, what God has created you for and what He's called you for, can be fed. It can be fed. And it's a supernatural life. When Paul was inspired by the Holy Spirit to write a book to an Ephesians church, a young group of believers, he said, "It's by grace through faith that you have been saved." And some of you, that happened this weekend. And in a minute, I want you to come and simply tell somebody, "That happened to me. Faith came in my heart. It's by God's grace that happened, through faith." So just as your salvation begins, so does the life of greatness. Greatness is about every single day showing up and doing the right thing. "God, I believe you. I'm going to do the right thing. God, it's tired. I can't see where I started, and I sure can't see where I'm going, but I'm going to trust you day by day. I want to do the right thing." And I can tell you this, the mature believers in this room have zero regret for moving their life in this direction. But some people sitting in this room today would say, "Oh God, I wish I could live my life over. I wish I could start over." We had a powerful word that Larry Cox said in our men's ministry on Friday. You know what the life of faith is about? Starting and starting over. And for some of us today, you got started, but you know what? You're over here. Start over. Get going down this trajectory of excellence in your life. I still believe God's looking to do great things in our world. I still believe God is calling out Joseph who's in obscurity and serving in Pharaoh's courts. I believe he's calling out Esther, a young woman who's going to be used to save a nation. Ruth, a widowed woman who God calls to leave her homeland, go to her mother-in-law and serve. I believe God's calling out David when he's a shepherd boy, had no idea to be king, let alone greatness would follow his life. God is still calling out people for greatness, and I believe he's calling you. That's why you were involved this weekend. It had no coincidence. No coincidence. You're sitting on a basketball court, football field, classroom, friend's house, playing ping pong. God drew you to hear what he wants in your life. I'm not going to manipulate that, but I'm not going to miss a moment to tell you. God is speaking to you if you're listening. The eyes of the Lord search to and fro across this land, seeking to strengthen those whose hearts are fully committed to him. There's power in faith. Feed it. Faith moves mountains. Feed it. Faith moves people. And faith may be moving you today. Hebrews 11:5. What is faith? Without faith, it's impossible to please God. Hebrews 11:1. Faith is confidence in what we hope for. It's assurance of what we do not see. Faith is being confident of who God is. That God is the author of the story. That he's written and he's got words for you and I. And we're simply listening to the author guiding the trajectory of our life. That's what faith is. Just keep showing up. Keep doing the right thing. Here's the last thing and I'm going to finish. Living up to your calling of greatness not only means disregarding the crowd, filling your mind with faith, means choosing the high ground. Choosing the high ground. You know, the crowd wants to take the easy way. They always want to go downhill. People of greatness are willing to push uphill. In Numbers 13 and Joshua 14, it recounts this. In Numbers 13, before this great moment when Caleb stands up, he had already said, "Give me Hebron. When we cross over to Promised Land, I want Hebron. Everybody else is going to run into the Fertile Crescent. They're going to run where all this is going." He says, "I want to go up into the hills. Because up into the hills where Abraham was buried. It's where Sarah was buried. It's where the heroes of the faith, Isaac, Rebecca, they were buried." He said, "I mean, it's sacred. It needs to be protected for the glory of God. I'm willing to climb this mountain and give me Hebron." And so later, when they're recounting the story, and it's found in Joshua 14, and they crossed over to the Promised Land. Moses didn't cross. He gives the mantle to Joshua. Joshua leads the people. He's strong and courageous. And they're into the Promised Land. As they're crossing over to the river, Caleb says, "I'm heading to Hebron. That's the place that God promised me." And the scripture says it this way. Joshua blessed Caleb. This is the Paul Harvey rest of the story. He gave him Hebron as his inheritance. The scripture says, and that land forever would be in the tribe of Judah of Caleb. Because he followed the Lord, the God of Israel, wholeheartedly. Students, I want to thank you for calling all of us to greatness. You've had a long, wonderful, exhausting weekend. You'd love to go home and take a nap right now. Okay? Nothing like a diet of exhaustion, staying up late, drinking Coke at 2 a.m. and popcorn at 4 a.m. and donuts on Sunday morning. But let me tell you, over the last 48 hours, among great friendships and fun, and raising cans and chasing and doing fun games, you've heard God speak to you. You've heard the words of your college leaders saying to you, "You can do this because God's been doing it for thousands of years." And over the last 2,000 years, the very Spirit of God is coming to dwell among believers. The very sanctuary of worship dwells within you according to God's word and his promises. And so thank you for calling us that we can live a life of purpose according to God's wills and his ways. God is still calling people to greatness. And I pray you'll respond to that. Now listen up, parents, grandparents, those who might be guests today. Anybody that's listening to the sound of my voice, somebody may watch this on tape later in the week or in the month. It's never too late to hear the voice of God. You're not too old to obey what God calls you to do. Your life can be one of greatness if you'll continue to hear the voice of God and follow. And I would tell you this, I could go through a long litany. God is not allowing you to retire in this area. We got lots of folks so that you could have the greatest handicap at the end of your life. Or that you call and check on your bank account every day. I'm going to be your pastor for a minute. God has not called us to fall into mediocrity and say, I've been there, I've done that, it's for the next generation. God is calling you to say, come with me, next generation. Come with me. God called me to greatness when I was a young person, or when he saved my life in the war, or he called me at some point in my life, and by grace he took me out of the wallow and the pit and put my feet on the solid rock and he put a song in my life. And whatever age I am going toward greatness. And I believe God's going to use it. Wellspring Church, mature, wealthy in spirit, wealthy in God's promises, people to lead the next generation. And I'm calling you out to greatness as well. I'm almost there with you. I'm so gray headed and get so old, man. I set up chairs yesterday. Had to go home and ask my wife to rub my feet and give me two more ibuprofen. I'm getting old in a hurry. We're going to hand this church over to passionate young people. God's going to take us home according to his promises until Jesus returns. This church and many others that God might birth, we're going to hand it over and entrust to reliable men and women who can hand it over to reliable men and women. We're going to be faithful in that. It's never too late to obey whatever God asks you to do. It's never too late to hear the voice of God. So let me ask you this. Are you asking for Hebrew? Are you willing to go to the higher ground? Are you willing to forget what the people say, especially the naysayers? And are you feeding your faith? Ask God for the calling on your life. So here it is. Mediocrity. Or a life of greatness. What's God called in you, and how are you going to respond?